Hey, I'm Christina May, the online pastor at World Harvest Church in Enid, Oklahoma. You're about to hear a spirit-filled message from our pastor. So grab your Bible, and if you're a coffee lover like me, grab a cup of coffee and get ready for a personal word that God has for you today.
Yeah, we always have to tell people when I preach that I'm not the pastor and that the pastor's gone, because at one time someone came up and said, hey, I've seen, you know, on the internet, and there's this young, good-looking guy, man. What are you doing up here? I said, well, come back next week. He'll be here. But you guys are tough. You know what I mean? It's rough out there today. You guys made it out here. Praise the Lord. I'm glad you're here. But we're in a series Pastor started at the first of the year called Elementary. And has anybody been loving that? I mean, have you guys liked it? I mean, it's the elementary teachings, but I just loved it. And we need to hear that every now and then. I was reminded of that just recently. I was reading through the book of Exodus. And it got to the part where the Israelites were out there going through the desert, and God told them, he said, I'm going to feed y'all. Every day, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to dump manna down on the ground, and all you got to do is come out and pick it up. And here's how you do it. I mean, he gave them explicit instructions. He said, go out there and get one omer for each person, i.e., you got six people in your house, get six omers, okay? Okay. Well, then it says that they went out there and a bunch of them got a whole bunch more. You know, like some of those folks you see at the smorgasbord, man, they were piling it on. And they got back. Well, what happened was they ate what they could, saved the rest of it overnight, and it rotted. And it said there were maggots in it. And then he told them, he said, I'm going to put it out there for 6 days. I mean, he explained it down to the level, I'm going to put it out there for 6 days, okay? And on the seventh day, I'm taking the seventh day off. That's the Sabbath. So on the sixth day, I'm going to put enough out there. You get two omers for each person. So what happens on the seventh day? You guessed it. Hey, God, we're out here for the manna. Where's it at? It's like, come on, McFly. But people don't listen. That's why I like this elementary series. Sometimes we just need to go back over those basic things of Christianity and remind it, because every now and then someone's not listening and they need to know. And this morning, we're going to be talking about the elementary teaching of salvation. Now, salvation, that's one of those, you don't hear that word out in the world much. It's one of those Christian words. You hear it in the church, and it simply means deliverance from the power and the effects of sin. That's Webster's, and that's a good definition of it. That's what salvation is. And it's a very important, in fact, I believe it's the most important fundamental elementary teaching there is, because it's the cornerstone, okay, of the foundation of the Christian life. When you're going to lay a foundation, you put the cornerstone in first. You got to get that right, because you're going to square, you're going to level everything off that cornerstone. You don't get it right, nothing else is going to be right. This is one that you really need to get right, salvation. And another definition, it means to change of direction. It's like you're going this way and you change direction. And that's what we do when we get saved. We're going away from God. We receive salvation. We start going towards God. And the Bible's filled with a lot of stories, a lot of good people who got radically saved. You know, one of them, Abraham, he was a pagan. He was living in Ur of the Chaldees. He had a whole pantheon full of gods until he met the one real God of the universe, and his life radically changed. He loaded up everything he had and he followed God. God did great things through him. God had a plan for his life. There was Moses, same thing. He had killed a man in Egypt. He was running from the law. He was out on the backside of the desert. But God had a plan for his life. God loved him. And God showed up one day in a burning bush, and he said, hey, Moses, take off your shoes. You're on holy ground. And after that, man, his life was radically changed. You get over in the New Testament, you know, you the apostles, Peter, for instance. Oh, Joe Lunchbox, man. He was just a fisherman. He went out to work every day. But Jesus came along, and he met Jesus. He received salvation. Jesus said, follow me. And he followed him, and he went from being a fisher of fish to a fisher of men. And then you get in the 19th chapter of Luke. I like that story about this guy named Zacchaeus. Y'all remember that? Zacchaeus was... That's before your time. But he did a little... You know it? But he met Jesus one day. Jesus said, Zacchaeus, I'm going to go to your house. I want to eat. And when he met Jesus, his life was radically changed. You know, he was a crook. He was a tax collector. But when he met Jesus, he received salvation. First thing he said was, half of everything I have, I'm going to give to the poor. And if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I'm going to pay back four times what I owe them. And you remember what Jesus said? Jesus said, today, salvation has come to this man and to his household. That's what salvation does. But one of my favorite of all times is a man named Saul. He's also known as the Apostle Paul. That's who we know him. I like guys like that. I know some of them. When they got saved, they got so saved, they saved their name. They changed their name because they were a new creation. That's what happened to Paul. And I want to look at his salvation story as we go in to the message on salvation this morning. If you got your Bibles with you and you want to follow along, I'm going to be in the 9th chapter of the book of Acts. Or if you'd like, just follow along on the screen. Meanwhile, Saul was breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogue in Damascus so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, that's followers of Jesus, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you, Lord? Saul asked. I'm Jesus whom you're persecuting, he replied. Now, get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do. The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound, but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he couldn't see anything. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. In Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called to him in a vision, Ananias? Yes, Lord, he answered. The Lord told him, go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him and restore his sight. Lord, Ananias said, I've heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he's come here with authority from the chief priest to arrest all who call on your name. But the Lord said to Ananias, go. The man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. Then Ananias went to the house and he entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he could see again. He got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word, and I pray, Lord, that you show us clearly everything you want us to know this morning about your wonderful gift of salvation. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Several years ago, I was going through a job interview for a driving job. I'm a truck driver. And it was a little bit more professional than some of them. You know, most of your interviews I go through, it's like, do you have a CDL? Yes. Do you have a medical card? Yes. Are you breathing? Yes. You're hired. But this one, they had an actual safety man. He was asking questions. I kind of like interviews anyway. And we were going back and forth. And then all of a sudden, right in the middle of the interview, he just threw out this off-the-wall question. And I'd heard that people do that, you know. Just, I don't know why they do it, just to see what you'll say. But he asked me, he said, so what is the most life-changing event that you've ever experienced? Now, either when he asks me a question, I'll look him in the eye and then I'll hesitate like I'm thinking and then I'll answer the question. But when he asked me that question, I didn't do it. I just shot him an answer back. I said, that's easy. The most life-changing event I've ever experienced is when I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior and I received God's free gift of salvation. I said, that changed my life forever. Now, I don't know if he'd ever heard that answer, and I don't know what he was expecting, but from the look on his face, it wasn't that. But he sat there a minute, and all of a sudden, he was like, well, praise the Lord. I got saved when I was in the fifth grade at a little Pentecostal church, and that was the end of the interview, pretty much. But you see, I wonder what would it, the Apostle Paul would have said if you would have asked him that same question. Hey, Paul, what's the most life-changing event you've ever experienced? Without a doubt, I think Paul would have said, one day I was out on a road to Damascus. I was as far from God as anyone could get, and Jesus came down there to me. And I accepted him as my Lord and Savior. And when I got up off the ground, he radically changed my life forever. You see, friend, that's exactly what salvation does. Now, Pastor Brad, he said it in every message so far, and I understand exactly what he's saying. He says every one of these teachings, he'll say, I could do a whole series on this. And when it comes to salvation, I could do a series for, or I probably couldn't. He could for probably 3-4 months and never exhaust this subject. And so I did a lot of prayer and I asked God, I said, God, I want to know the most basic elementary teaching, because if there's someone out there who has not received this gift, they haven't had their life changed. I want them to be able to understand just what it is. And I remember in those times of prayer, there's a couple times, I mean, I almost started crying. I cried. Don't tell anybody. But he just overwhelmingly told me, how much you got to tell the people how much I love them, you know, and how much I want them to have a relationship with them. Just make sure you tell them that. And I said, okay, God. And then he gave me 3 points, and I want to look at this elementary teaching of salvation in these 3 points. The first thing I want us to see the human situation, okay? Then I want to see the heavenly solution. And the last thing we're going to look at is the humble submission. Okay, the first thing I want to see, the human situation. Back in verse 1, it says, meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus so that if he found anyone there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners. Now, by the way, Saul was a religious person. You know, he was following God, or so he thought he was. But Saul, he had a big problem. And it's the same problem each and every one of us has. And it's the human situation. And that human situation is called sin. You see, folks, we're all sinners. And that's the problem. We're sinners by birth. We're sinners by nature. I mean, let's go ahead and throw it out there. Sometimes we're sinners by choice. And because we're sinners, that sin has separated us from God. Isaiah 59, verse 2. Be sure to know that your sin has separated you from your God. Started way back in the Garden of Eden. You see, God created the universe, and then he created the earth, and then he created mankind. And he created us so he could have someone to love on, someone who he could fellowship with. I mean, I look back at I just imagine sometime what happened there at the Garden of Eden. You know, God, it said that God would go down and talk to him in the cool of the day. He'd go down there, and there'd be Adam and Eve, and he said, let's go for a walk. It'd be so cool walking around with God in the garden. God'd say, hey, come here, I want you guys to see something. And they'd round the corner, and here's this beautiful waterfall coming down. And, you know, the mist coming up and the lights coming through it like a rainbow. And Adam and Eve would look at it and go, wow, God, that's beautiful. I know. I made it for you because I love you. They walk a little bit further, and God would reach up there in this tree, grab a fruit down, and say, here, eat some of this. And they'd eat it, be slobbering. Man, I mean, juicy. God, wow, that's good. What is that? That's a peach. I made that for you so that you could enjoy it because I love you. And that's how it was in the garden. And God's told, the one thing he did, though, he gave mankind the freedom to choose, the freedom of choice, because he didn't want them to love him just because they had to. He wanted them to choose to love him and to follow him. And so God said, everything you have here is yours. If you need anything else, let me know. I'll make you more. I love you. Except for one thing, guys. I got a tree out here in the middle of the garden. It's a tree of knowledge of good and evil. Yeah, that one right there. That's my tree. Don't touch it. Because in the day you touch it, you're going to surely die. And God went on. And we all know what happened. One day, for some reason, the serpent deceived them into eating the apple from the fruit from the tree of the of good and evil. And they ate it. And the minute they did, sin entered into the world. And God cannot come into contact with sin. He can't have fellowship with sin. So the only thing he could do was take the people he loved and put them on the outside of the garden. And he was on the inside of the garden. And now mankind was separated from God. I asked God, I spent a lot of time on prayer on this, God, give me some picture. You know, I need a picture of what that was like to explain it to everybody. By the way, when I read books, I gotta have those books with big print and a lot of pictures. Yeah, I get that. So he gave me this word picture. He said, you know the Great Wall of China? Yeah, you know, 30 feet tall. 20. Well, just think of a wall that's about 100 times larger. That's what happened. When mankind sinned, now God and the kingdom of God are on this side. And then there's a wall went up, an impregnable wall. And out here on this side, out here in the desert, here's Adam and Eve and all mankind, everyone who was born to them. And they're separated by this huge wall. And what happened was every time Adam and Eve had kids, they just passed that sin down. Romans chapter 5, verse 12, it says, sin entered the world through one man, and therefore death through sin. And then everyone experiences death because all have sinned. You see, folks, we're sinners, and because we're sinners, we're separated from God. But you see, every one of us, we still carry in us what Adam and Eve had, you know. We want to be in fellowship with God. We have this God-shaped vacuum in us. That's what C.L. Lewis said, C.S. Lewis. And we're trying to fill this God-shaped vacuum up. And a lot of us use religion. Some of us use money. Some of us use a good time. But we're always seeking some way to get to God. Sometimes we try to climb up that wall That's religion. You want to know what religion is? Religion is man's attempt to get to God. You know, if I can just be good enough, if I can just get up that wall, I can be back with God. I tried that, folks. It doesn't work. I get about 100 feet up and fall back down. But that's what we do. And you ask the normal person out there, what do you got to do to be right with God? Well, as long as you're good, you know. Some people who are religious say, hey, well, if you go to confirmation class, I went to confirmation, then I got baptized, and I go to church, and I give my tithe, and I pray, and I read my Bible, I'm good with God. No. You see, the Bible says in Titus 3, verse 5, for it is not by works of righteousness which we have done, but it's according to his mercy that he saves us. It says in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, for we are saved by grace through faith and not of ourselves. It's a gift from God, not of works, lest any man should boast. You can't get there by religion. I tried it myself when I was coming to God. I was tithing, and I don't mean Christian giving, folks. I take that paycheck divided by 10 and round it up to the nearest dollar so I didn't short God. I go to church every chance I got. I was reading the Bible. I almost read the whole Bible before I got saved. I was reading large chunks. Shoot, I even bought a new set of Sunday go-to-meeting clothes. I had a necktie and the whole nine yards. Surely I was right with God. No. Because you see, it's not by works. In fact, if there was anyone who could get to heaven by being religious or good works, it would have been this guy right here, Saul. He was a Pharisee. He was a Pharisee of the Pharisees. He was from the tribe of Benjamin. And not only that, he was a Pharisee. To be a Pharisee, you had to memorize the first five books of the Bible. Yeah, most Christians haven't even read the first five books. Saul had them memorized. Man, he tithed everything. He fasted 3 days a week because he was trying to please God. He was climbing that wall. Sure enough, every time he'd fall back down. You see, folks, that's the human situation. In a nutshell, here it is. Man is separated from God because of sin, and there's nothing he can do to repair that relationship. One time I was witnessing to a guy, another driver, and I brought this up. I said, you know, have you ever sinned? Well, usually someone said, well, yeah, but he's like, he thought about it a while. He was genuine. He said, no, I've never sinned. I said, okay, what are you saying? Okay, well, here's the deal. Because your offspring of Adam and Eve, they sinned, and you inherited sin from them. And he looked at me and he said, that's not fair. And praise God to the Holy Spirit. Never be afraid to share your faith, because he's going to give you the words to say. He promised that. And he just gave me the words. I said, no, it's not fair. And you want to know who else didn't think it was fair? God didn't think it was fair. So you know what God did for the human situation? God came up with a heavenly solution. And I want to look at that next. Continue reading. Verse 3. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you, Lord? Saul asked. I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting, he replied. Now get up and go into the city, and I'm going to tell you what you need to do. You see, when we couldn't come to God, God came to us. That's the heavenly solution. Once again, I'm going to tell you, God wants to have that relationship with you. I'm going to tell you again, God loves you more than anything. He has a plan for your life, just like he did Saul's, but he couldn't work that plan out until he got Saul back in relationship with him. God started working on the plan of salvation before the world was ever formed. You see, God's omnipotent. He knows everything. He knew, he made mankind even though he knew he was going to sin. In the book of the Revelation, they refer to Jesus as the Lamb who was slain from the foundations of the earth. The plan of salvation, God had already planned on it before he ever slung this universe into existence. It didn't come as a surprise to God. So here, what he did, I'm going to make a way. You see, here's the thing. Sin is a crime. Sin, your sin has to be punished. And the punishment for sin is death. So what God did, he sent his son down to earth, Jesus. Jesus was born of a virgin. Don't ever let anyone tell you that the virgin birth is not important. It's fundamental because God took his sinless seed and he placed it in the womb of a virgin. So when Jesus was born, he didn't have that sin nature in him like we do. Don't let anybody tell you he was just a man. No, he was man and God. And Jesus lived a perfectly sinless life for 33 years. And at the exact time, God took precious Lamb of God, his Lamb, and he sacrificed him on the cross for your sins and my sins and the sins of the world. Your crime was paid for by Jesus. Your sin that required you to die, Jesus said, I'll die for him. I'll pay for it. I'll do the penalty. From noon till 3 o'clock, if you remember the story, Jesus hung on the cross. The lights went out. It was completely dark. I believe with all my heart the reason for that darkness was because of all the sin. All the sin in the past, all the sin that would ever be done, all that sin was put on Jesus' back. He suffered for our sin, and that sin was so dirty, it was so ominous that it darkened the sky for 3 hours. And when he was finished, when that last sin had been paid for, Jesus cried out, Tetelestai, it is finished. Debt paid in full. And he gave up the ghost and died. And they buried him. And he was in the earth for 3 days. And after that 3 days, he rose up again. And he conquered death. And he ascended into heaven where he sits right now, ever making submission for the saints. Jesus paid our sin debt. That was God's solution. Look at it this way. Let's go back to the wall. We got this big wall. God said, I want those people on my side of the wall because I want to have a relationship. But they're sinners. We got to pay their sin debt so they can get through. So Jesus did that. When Jesus did that, Jesus blew a hole right through that wall. He made a way where there was no way. Jesus is the door. He is the gate for us. That's what salvation is. In fact, Jesus said that himself. John 10, verse 9, Jesus said, I am the gate. The English Standard Version says, I'm the door. He said, anybody who comes through me will be saved. Anybody who comes through me will receive the gift of salvation. You know, a lot of people don't like that, and here's why. Okay, God made a way, salvation. Jesus Christ is not just one of the ways to heaven, okay? He's not even the best way to heaven. Jesus Christ is the only way to get to heaven. The only way you're going to get through that wall is through the gate that Jesus opened for you. Now, people don't like to hear that, and it's hard because there's a lot of religions out there, and there's a lot of people trying to get to God. And people will say, well, what about all the other people? You know, what about the people who were worshiping other gods? What about them? Aren't they going to go to heaven? I'm just going to tell you what the Bible says. Jesus said he was the only way. I was in a Sunday school class one time, and one of the people said, well, I believe that there's one God, but I believe there's many ways to get to him. And I just said to him, I said, so in other words, you think Jesus is a bald-faced liar, right? Boy, don't start fights in Sunday school, man. She was big, too. But now, I told her, I'm not trying to be mean when I say that, okay? I just wanted to get the jolt of it. And here's why. Because, look at me. Okay, Jesus said he's the only way to heaven. John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. Not only that, he said in John 3:3, if you're going to come into the kingdom of God, you must be born again. Acts chapter 4, verse 12, there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. But Jesus said he's the only way to heaven, and you're telling me there's a bunch of ways. So if you're saying there's a bunch of ways, you're telling Jesus he's wrong. Now, who am I going to believe? I'm going to believe Jesus because he hadn't never steered me wrong yet. Didn't like a... But you see, friend, a lot of people have called me narrow. Hey, Bud, you sit there at all religion and you're saying that Jesus is the only way. That's narrow. I can't even believe you think that. I don't have an argument for that. You know, it is narrow. But you want to know what? There's only one way. But at least there's a way. I'm glad there's a way that he made a way. And you know what? Jesus wouldn't argue with you either. Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 and 14, Jesus said, you need to make sure and enter in through the narrow gate because wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. That's all the other religions. They're all holding hands, singing Kumbaya, going down the road to destruction. But Jesus said, narrow is the gate. And straight is the way that leads to eternal life, and few there are who will go therein. Friend, I am just thrilled to death that there's a gate and that there's a way. That's the heavenly solution to the human situation. Last thing I want you to see is the humble submission. Wait, I want to make one other one, comment on that last one. You know, I don't have a problem with Jesus being the only way because I make my living following directions. I'm a truck driver. And I remember, it was back in the 90s, I was working for a major carrier. And the first 2 months of that year, January and February, in Chicago, which is the low underpass capital of the world, we had already topped out 38 trailers, drivers running them under underpasses. You know, we got this one on Main Street. We get two or three a year. And Lisa asked me, why do those drivers keep doing that? They're following the GPS, most of them. But you see, I never run under one. Because here's what I did. I called. You know, if I was going to going to a ship or a receiver, I called them first and I got directions. And I didn't want to talk to the receptionist. You know, she got her car there. I don't care how you got there. I want to talk to God deals with big trucks. And I get instructions from him how to get in there because he wanted me in there. Either I had what he wanted or he wanted me to haul out what he had, but he's going to make sure I got in there. And I remember one time in particular, I'd called up and the guy was giving me directions. And he said, you know, turn here. When you get to the light, turn right. Yada, yada. And he said, when you make that right, you're going to come up on an underpass. And that underpass is marked 13-2. He said, you can't get your truck under it. Here's what you need to do. It's not a busy road. Just wait till it's clear. Go over in the other lane. Go under the underpass and then get back in your lane. You'll get right there. Now, he told me, he said, you need to follow these instructions, driver, because this is the only way to get in here. And if you try to get in another way, you're going to be in a bind. You want to know what I did? I didn't call him narrow. I didn't say, look, dude, what's your problem? There's 100,000 roads in Chicago, and you're going to try to tell me that that's the only way? I didn't do that. No, you want to know what I did? I wrote down the directions. And when I got done writing them down, I read them back to him because I want to make sure I knew what I was doing. Then when I got there, I had those directions in my hand. Right there. But sure enough, there's this underpass. I didn't try to squeeze under it. I waited till it was clear, got under it, right there. No problem, folks. But you see, you got a lot of people nowadays trying to get into heaven, and they're following directions from somewhere else, and they're jamming their lives under the underpasses of life trying to get through them when they can't get through them because they're not getting the directions from the right people. You know, if I want to get to heaven, guess who I'm going to ask? I'm going to ask Jesus, because God made heaven and God's the one. I'm not going to call Buddha up and ask him how to get to heaven, because it's not his heaven. I'm going to ask God, how do I get there? And when I get, and I'm going to follow what he says. You see, that's the heavenly solution to the human situation. But there's one last thing, folks. When you get to that gate, there has to be a humble submission for you to get through to that relationship with God that he wants so desperately to have with you. Just like the Apostle Paul, I won't read the rest, but his story. You know, he told Ananias, this is my man. He's going to take the gospel to the world. He's going to write 2/3 of the New Testament. But before he can do, I got a plan for his life. I love him. But before he does any of that, I got to get him saved. So here's what God did. He made that way, and he made it so easy. He said, all you got to do is come there. Here Paul was for 3 days. Not eating, not drinking, blind. And I can just imagine what happened in those 3 days, because that's what happened to me when I came to God. All of a sudden, God showed me that I was a sinner and how I had sinned against him. It had me weeping to see what I had done to the holy God of the universe. I couldn't believe I had done some of the things I did. He just kept showing me. But then he showed me what he did. He said, I can save you. And he did. And that's what he did to the Apostle Paul. Paul submitted himself to Jesus. He humbly submitted himself and asked God to save him. See, he was already saved when Ananias came in, because Ananias called him brother. That means that's what they called each other if they were saints. Paul got saved in that time. You know what you got to do to be saved? Ask. That's it. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. If you'll confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth one confesses unto salvation. And verse 13 says, whosoever, that's you, whosoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. It's that easy. I've had people tell me, nah, it's not that easy. You got to do something else. What else you got to do? You don't have to do anything else. He had to make it easy because he wanted truck drivers to be up there with him too. If he made it any harder, we wouldn't have got in. And here's the wonderful thing about it. When Paul got saved, he was a brand new creation in Christ. That's what, see, you come through the gate, go through that wall, you come out the other side. All this sin that I had been carrying all my life, I got so used to it, I didn't even know it was there. But when I walked through that gate, that sin came off. Jesus paid for it. And when I submitted myself and came through, I was a new creation. God didn't take something that was broken and fix it. He took something that was dead and he made it alive. 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Behold, the old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. When I walked out that other side, I was a new person. And so was the Apostle Paul. That's the humble submission. It's that easy, folks. That's all you have to do. I'm going to tell you one more time because God told me to tell you. He loves you because he made you. He loves you with an everlasting love. If you only knew how much he loves you. And he has a plan for your life and he wants to get that plan started. But first, you got to get rid of that human situation through his heavenly solution by your humble submission. You know, years ago, well, it hasn't been all that long ago, we used to go to a bunch of OSU football games. And I never bought a ticket, man. It's usually one of Lisa's sisters would call up, hey, so-and-so's not going to the game. We got tickets. You want to go? And, you know, it all depended on, I think Steve called me a couple times. But I just didn't pay for any tickets. There was always one available. And you know, it depends, you know, what's the weather like, who are they playing, where are the seats at. But there was one ticket her sister would have. And if she had that ticket, homeboy was going to the game. Because this ticket, get this, 45-yard line on the west end of the 50, 35 rows up, sweep. I mean, you could see everything going on both ways, and you were close enough to see the people, but you were far up enough to see the whole field. I mean, it didn't matter what was going on. Weather, if I had to work, I just had to cancel it because I'm going to go sit in those seats. And here's why I liked them. You see, these seats, I couldn't pay for these seats. See, I'm a truck driver. I don't make enough for these seats. Yeah, maybe if I rearrange my budget and quit funding my retirement account and maybe not eat 3 days a week, then I could afford them. But I still couldn't buy them. Because in order to buy these tickets, you got to be a member of the Posse Club. And I don't have that kind of money. But you see, the guy who had those tickets, he wasn't a truck driver. He owned a trucking company. Yeah. Eye glass. And I couldn't afford one seat. He'd buy a whole row. And when she said, I got eye glass tickets, I'm like, I'm going. You know, the only way I could get those seats, that's if I got my end zone ticket and creeped up there and I saw a couple seats, I'd run down there and snag them. But even that didn't work because you in that section, you got the ticket Nazis running around. They'd be like, hey, driver, what are you doing sitting in that seat? You got to get out of here. Go back to the end zone. But you see, when I said, yes, I want that ticket immediately, that seat had my name on it. Whether I went to the game or not, whether I made it, those two seats had my name on it because I said I wanted them. I didn't buy them. Someone who had a whole lot more than me, he purchased them. But there was still a problem. I had to get to the seats. Well, I talked to her on the phone. It's easy. When you get to the stadium, do this. Go to the west end, and there's a bunch of ticket booths, and one of them will say, will call, W-I-L-L-C-A-L-L. You go up to that window and tell them your name, and they'll give you the tickets. I'm like, no, I got to be harder than that. No, it doesn't. Just tell them your name. So sure enough, we went there. Look, sure enough, there was will call. Went up to the window. Hey, told him my name. Here's your ticket, sir. Enjoy the game. Got up to the gate. Give him my tickets. Enjoy the game. Walk up there to the high roller section. I find my seats, and I sit down in them. Ticket Nazi come by and say, hey, driver, those seats are reserved. I got tickets. Ike Glass said I could sit here. You got a problem with that? No, sir. Enjoy the game. Plan to. But you see, folks, this gift of salvation, it's a whole lot like that. You see, there's a seat, whether you're saved or not, there's a seat in heaven with your name on it because someone who has a whole lot more than you do, he purchased that seat for you. And whether you use it or not, it's up to you. If the end of the world comes and you haven't received Christ as your Savior, that seat, is up there and it's going to go unused. But how do you access that seed? Easy. Will call. Whosoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. That's a truck driver paraphrase. All you got to do is ask. You get that ticket, you walk through the gate, enjoy heaven. Absolutely. I walk up in my seat. You're a truck driver, aren't you? Yeah, what are you doing up here? Tickets. Jesus said I could come up here. You see, I'll be in heaven because Jesus let me. What about you? If I were to ask you that very same question that that guy asked me, what was the most life-changing event that's ever taken place in your life? How would you answer that? I'm pretty much convinced if you can't say it was when I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior and I received his gift of salvation, it changed me forever. You really need to look at it. Especially if you've been trying as hard as you can, you don't feel like you're getting anywhere. You see, God loves you. He has a plan for your life, but you got to step into the kingdom. And once you step into the kingdom, you'll never look back. Amen? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much. It's an elementary thing, salvation, but it's so important. And Jesus, I thank you that you paid the way for us. And I thank you that you made it so easy for us. And Lord, right now, there's some people out there maybe who never have experienced that. And Lord, I just pray that maybe today from something that was preached, something that was said, that they would see what it is they need to do. And I just pray that they'll come today, that they'll pray that prayer of salvation, and that they'd enter in and become a new creation in Christ. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thanks again for listening. We hope that this message inspires, challenges, and fuels you up to take a real Jesus to a real world. If you'd like to connect with us in any way, please go to harvestenid.com/connect. Or if you'd like to learn more about us as a church, please go and check us out at harvestenid.com. We can't wait to share another message with you next week.